Good afternoon. Welcome to EduSet Network. Friend, you know, this will be our series of lecture on Gupta period. And in the last lecture, we tried to understand the polity, administration and educational institution. And while talking, we also come to know that Gupta period is known as the golden age. Why it was golden age? The people say that literature and art and architecture by that climax, that's why it is called a golden age in the history of India. And one of the historian, famous historian, Max Muller, also calls it Renaissance, literary Renaissance. So we'll try to understand in today's lecture, literature, art and architecture. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio Dr. O.P. Singh. He teaches history in Delhi College of Arts and Commerce, in Delhi University, and has a specialization in ancient Indian history. So I think his knowledge and experience of teaching will help us to understand this topic and give insights on your behalf. I welcome him for the EduSet lecture on this very topic.
Thank you, Amrinderji, and good afternoon, viewers. In today's lecture, we shall be focusing on literary tradition during Gupta period, art, various forms of art, and architecture. There too are various forms. Now, what we see during Gupta period in the field of art and culture is that Gupta period saw a magnificent achievement in the realms of literature, art and architecture. In fact, especially speaking about Sanskrit literature, this was a period of growth for Sanskrit literature. And as Amarendraji said, although Max Muller calls it the period of Renaissance for Sanskrit literature, but this has been questioned by a number of scholars. Now, we shall not be going into that debate, but the period may not be called Renaissance from the point of view of Sanskrit literature, but definitely it was a period of climax for Sanskrit literature. Now, Gupta period also witnessed extreme development in the realms of painting and sculpture, and actually it marks the culmination of earlier developments in these forms of arts. Now, literary tradition is best marked in the field of Brahmanical literature. Especially, the Brahmanical literature that we have today, this form was actually given to these literatures during Gupta period only. For example, whether these are Mahabharata or Ramayana or the Vedas, Upanishads, all these literature in the form they exist today, these forms were given to this literature during Gupta period only. So from this point of view, it was a very significant period. Now, speaking about various Brahmanical literature, let us first talk about the Smritis and the Puranas. Now, Yajnavalkya Smriti and Brihaspati, Yajnavalkya Smriti, Brihaspati Smriti and Narad Smriti are said to have been composed during Gupta period. However, Yajnavalkya Smriti may be regarded as the official law book for the Gupta period. Now, the original text, apart from it, original texts of various other Smritis were also composed during Gupta age, and probably during later times, further modifications were made in this literature. If we believe P.V. Kane, he says that various Smritis were wrote during this period. This basically belong Parasar Smriti, which is said to be composed between 100 to 500 AD. Katyayana Smriti is said to have been composed during 400 to 600 AD. Pitamaha Smriti was composed during 400 to 700 AD. Pulastya Smriti was composed during 300 to 700 AD. Vyasa Smriti also between 200 to 500 AD. And Harit Smriti was written during 400 to 700 AD. So what you find that a large number of Smritis are composed during this period. Now it's a different matter that a number of them were further elaborated upon during later times, but most of them were composed during Gupta period only. Now if we look at Puranas, we find that their number increased during Gupta period. Now, various regions have been cited for the increase in the number of Puranas during Gupta period. But a very important reason for this is that because of changes in socio-economic condition of the period, various new sects emerged. and these Puranas accommodated various views in various Puranas during Gupta period. For example, the Pasupat sect, which was related to Shaivism, finds mention in Vayu and Linga Purana. Satvat sect, that is related to Vaishnavism, is referred in Vishnu Purana. Now, apart from these religious sects, various branches of secular knowledge were also incorporated in these Puranas. For example, Agni Purana is a thesaurus of poetics, dramatics, astronomy, astrology, etc., etc. Another Purana, that is Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, is related to arts of dance, painting, and sculpture. And Garuda Purana is related to perfumery and lapidary artwork. Now, these are such activities which, if we look at past developments right from post-Mauryan times to Gupta times, we find that our number of art and craft increased tremendously. Now, this has been referred in a number of Buddhist literature also, but this also find mentions in contemporary Brahmanical religious literature, and this is a very significant development. Now, apart from this religious literature, especially Smritis and Puranas, that emerged as a huge source of information during Gupta period, we have other category of literature also that flourished during Gupta period. For example, in the category of ballet literature, the most outstanding name is that of Kalidas, who was a contemporary of Chandragupta II, also known as Vikramaditya. Now, there are various scholars who still believe that Kalidas lived at the court of Vikramaditya of Ujjain, but very few scholars are of this opinion. It's generally believed that Kalidas was at the court of Gupta ruler Chandragupta II, the Vikramaditya. Now, in ballets or Kavya literature, the most outstanding name that we said is that of Kalidas, and he is in fact the most outstanding genius of the period, because his supremacy was unquestioned as far as his literature is concerned. And this supremacy was because of two reasons. First, that most of the earlier writers, however great they were extremely relegated to oblivion after coming of Kalidas or by the writings of the Kalidas. And second, the literary fashion started by Kalidas in the form and content was further imitated by most of the writers of later times. So that is why the importance of Kalidas in the field of literature, especially ballet literature or non-religious literature, is very important. Now, in this category of non-religious literature, and talking of Kalidas, and since we are talking about ballet literature, the earliest poem is Ritu Samhar. Now, this is basically a description of six seasons, and it lacks, you know, didactic and ethical qualities. And on the basis of it, it has been asked by some people, rather it has been suggested by people, that probably it was not authored by Kalidas, but nevertheless there is no doubt about its authorship, and it, Ritu Samhar was definitely written by Kalidas only. However, Ritu Samhar actually exhibits some poetical features which shows the author of Meghdoot, because the kind of development and maturity that we find in ballet literature in Meghdoot is definitely not there in Ritu Samhar. But this beginning attains its maturity and becomes more powerful in Meghdootam. Then his other two ballet literature, Kumar Sambhav and Raghuvansam, are basically epics which are related to different stories. Now, next author in importance during Gupta period besides Kalidas is Bharvi, who flourished around 550 AD, and he wrote the famous epic called Kirat Arjuniya, which is a story of fight between Arjun and Shiva. And in the writings of Bharvi, what you find that he is greatly influenced by Kalidas. So the point that we made a little while ago, that later, it's not only that earlier authors were relegated to oblivion, but even later authors also followed the style and the pattern adopted by Kalidas. Now, apart from this ballet literature, we have another category in literary category literature, and that is of drama. Now, in dramatical literature, Sudrak's Mrishkatikam is a very famous drama, as we all know. But basically, Sudrak's Mrishkatikam is a revised and enlarged version of Vasa's another drama that is called Daridri Charudat. So, various names of characters are in fact borrowed from Daridri Charudat in Mrishkatikam. Now, Sudrak added to it a subplot of political revolution by Aryak, and needless to say, Sudrak's Mrishkatikam is more popular than Bhasa's Daridri Charudat. Now, besides Sudrak, we have another great dramatist of the period, who is Vishakhdatta, who wrote three plays. His Mudra Rakshas is a historical play. It deals with political strategy and counter strategy, plotting and counter plotting by Chandragupta Maurya. And rather by the patron, rather by the ideologues of Chandragupta Maurya and Dhanananda, and ultimately it is found that Dhanananda's ideologue Rakshas accepts his defeat, and it's based on that. Now, this drama is important from the point of view that most of the dramas written during period revolve around the theme of love, whereas this drama, that is Mudra Rakshas, revolves around historical events, rather patriotism. Now, his another drama by Vishakhdatta is Devi Chandraguptam, which revolves around the story of Ramgupta, Chandragupta and Dhruv Devi. Now, we shall not be going into the details of those stories. And a third drama is written by him. It's called Abhisarik Vanchitak. Now, this is based on love stories of Udayan, who was the ruler of Pataliputra. Now, this category of drama achieved its high water mark during Kalidas, rather in the writings of Kalidas, who also wrote a very few famous dramas. One of his three dramas was Malvikagnimitra, which revolves around the story of Sunga ruler Agnimitra and Malvika. In fact, it is his first drama, so it's not very mature in as far as style is concerned. Now, his another drama is Vikramur Vasya, which is a romantic story of love of a mortal for a nymph. And the mortal is Vikram and the nymph is Urvasi in this case, and it is basically an erotic play. But the theme of love, started by Kalidas in his dramas, reaches its highest consummation in his third play, which is popularly known as Abhigyan Sakuntalam. Now, in Kalidasa's drama, what we find that imagination dominates fact and reason, whereas in the plays of Sudrak and Vishakhdatta, what we find that facts and reason dominate imagination. So, by and large, what we can say about Gupta literature, this category of literature, is that it was more of a court literature, and it was hardly concerned with the life of common people. It was mostly concerned with the life of elites centered around court life. Now, moving out of this category, another category of literature that flourished during Gupta period is that of ethical and didactical nature. That is, literature related to moralizing or preaching kind of literature. And in this category, Tantrikaik, which is popularly known as Panch Tantra, was written by Vishnu Sarma. Another collection is Brihat Katha Manjari, which was written by Chhemendra, and Katha Sarit Sagar, which was written by Somdev. Now, these are literature which are percepting and moralizing in nature, and this literature can be placed under didactic and ethical literature. Now, apart from it, Gupta period also witnessed a number of grammatical writings as well. Now, as far as grammatical and lexicographical writing is concerned, the most important writing during Gupta period is Katantar, that was written by a person called Sarvabarman. But apart from Katantar, we have another very famous grammar that is known as Chandra Vyakran, which was written by Chandra Gomin. And Chandra Gomin also wrote a commentary on his own grammar that is called Chandra Vritti. Now, Vararuchi was another important grammarian of the period, and Vararuchi was one of the 9 gems which were there at the court of Chandragupta II. So, Vararuchi was a very important grammarian, very famous grammarian of the period, and he wrote a grammar called Vartika. And he also wrote another grammar called Prakriti Prakas. Needless to say, it was grammar that revolved around Prakrit language, or it was a Prakrit grammar. Now, the most famous lexicographical work in Sanskrit during Gupta period is that by Amar Kosh. The book is called Nam Linganusasan, but it is popularly known as Amar Kosh, which was written by a person called Amar Simh. Now, moving out of this category of religious and belles and grammatical and dramatical literature, we also find some very important development in the field of mathematics and astronomy. Now, mathematics basically developed as an auxiliary of astronomy, or it can be said vice versa also, because these were part of contemporary Vedic ritual. And the most important contribution in mathematics during Gupta period is one called Panch Siddhantika by Varahmihir, and another is Aryabhattiyam by famous astronomer Aryabhatta. Now, apart from mathematics and astronomy, astrology was also enriched during Gupta period. Now, astrology basically revolved around it was mainly concerned with various occasions, auspicious occasions in fact, and in this field, Varahmihir has contributed a lot through his celebrated text called Brihat Samhita. He also wrote Brihat Vivah Patal and Swalp Vivah Patal, which were related to auspicious occasions or Muhurta related to marriages. Now, Varahamihir's son Prithu Yasas was also a celebrated astrologer of his time, and he was a student of his father, and he wrote a very famous work on astrology that is called Hor Sapt Panchasik, that is used by Brahmanas today for the purpose of auspicious occasions and auspicious time, that is Muhurta. Now, talking about this astrology category of literature, what you find that the most important contribution in astrology was made by Aryabhatta, because he is the person who said during Gupta period only that the earth revolves or rotates around its axis. Now his successor Varahamihir and Brahmagupta rejected it, but nevertheless it was later established by scientific methods that this is actually the fact. Now apart from this, Aryabhatta also made some another contributions which stand true even today. For example, he devised the formula to measure the increase or decrease in the duration of two consecutive days. He also developed the theory to explain the variation in planetary motion. He stated accurately the angular diameter of Earth's shadow at Moon's orbit and gave the method for finding the duration of an eclipse. So this is a very significant development from the point of view of astronomy during Gupta period. And Aryabhatta also correctly calculated the length of a year, and he devised the formula to how to correctly calculate the length of a year. Now, as far as another celebrated astronomer of the period, Varahamihir, is concerned, Varahamihir was also one of the 9 gems at the court of Chandragupta II or Vikramaditya, who authored Panch Siddhantika. Basically, in Panch Siddhantika, what he has done, he has preserved the previous 5 Siddhantas related to astronomy. These previous 5 Siddhantas were Paitamaha Siddhant, Vasishtha Siddhant, Polis Siddhant, Romanka Siddhant, and Surya Siddhant. So he is credited with preserving those 5 previous Siddhantas and compiling them into one, which is this Pancha Siddhantika. It's a very important text from the point of view of astronomy in ancient India, and there is no parallel anywhere in the world to this text during contemporary times. Then apart from this category of astronomy and astrology, medicine was another important category on which there are not as much as texts as compared to other disciplines. But even in the field of medicine, we have a famous text called Navneetak, which basically deals with various kinds of medicines such as powders and oils that were used in various diseases. And also a considerable portion of this text is dedicated or devoted to the disease of children, various types of disease with which children were affected. A significant portion of this text, Navneetak, deals with the disease of the children. Now, in chemistry, we have no specific work that has come down to us that belongs to this period. But nevertheless, the great Mahayanist philosopher Nagarjuna is believed to be the father of chemistry in contemporary literature for his contribution. Now, development in chemistry, there is no literary contribution, but this development can be assumed from the substantial development in the field of metallurgy, because what we find that during this period, very high quality of metallurgy was in practice. And especially if we talk about certain examples, for example, the Mehrauli pillar in Delhi, or the copper statue of Buddha from Sultanganj in Bihar, these are some examples of development in metallurgy that also speak about development in chemistry, though there is no specific text that can be ascribed to this period. So these are the literature which flourished during Gupta period. But we see that this literature included religious literature in the form of Puranas and Smritis. It also included secular literature in the forms of ballet literature, epics, and dramas. We also have scientific literature. We have literature related to astronomy and astrology and so on and so forth, even mathematics. What is significant, I would like to underline this point, is that most of this literature that we have during Gupta period is court literature that revolves around the lives of the people of court, and hardly any of this literature, barring a few, like Sudrak's Mishkatikam, hardly any of these speak about the life of common people or the problems being faced by common people in the contemporary time. Now, moving apart from this literature category, let us now focus on the developments taking place in the field of art. Now, here in art, we shall be focusing only on two aspects of art. One is painting and other is sculpture. Now, as far as paintings are concerned, no paintings of this period have survived in North India. But however, there are a number of painting remains that belong to Gupta period, and they come from Deccan and South India. So the study of the paintings from Deccan and South India almost amounts to the study of paintings of Gupta period. Now, a faint traces of these paintings can be noted in the caves of Kanheri. Talking about Deccan and South, we can find it in the caves of Kanheri, Aurangabad, Pitalkhora. But the most significant remains of Gupta paintings are found in the caves of Ajanta, Badami and Bagh. And it's important to see that all of them mostly belong to 6th century BC. Now, apart from Ellora painting, which belongs to 750 AD or mid 8th century. So, by far the most significant center of pictorial art is Ajanta painting, and we shall be making our inferences based on Ajanta paintings only. Now, if we look at contemporary literature reveals that painting was a very significant art, and it was popular amongst various sections of the society at that time. Buddhist literature like Mahavastu of earlier times and Kama Sutra of Gupta times, they include painting as one of the arts of the people. So painting was very much there, though it's unfortunate that very few remains of paintings have survived from North India, and most of them come from Deccan and South India. So as we said, we shall be talking about painting and especially about Ajanta paintings. Now, what we have in Ajanta paintings is that all these paintings have survived in various caves in Ajanta, and these are wall paintings, so the wall or the surface was prepared. Because contemporary literature talks about three types of surfaces for painting purposes. One is pat, that is canvas. Second is pat, that is wooden board. And third is bhiti, that is wall. So the first two categories do not survive because of their perishable nature. However, remains of bhiti painting or wall paintings have survived to us, and they mostly come from Ajanta or from various caves of Ajanta. So what we find in Ajanta paintings that these paintings are representational in character, and most of them depict the themes related to Buddha and his life, and these themes are taken from Jataka stories and various other stories related to the life of the Buddha. Now, the painters of Gupta period is said to have included various aspects of painting, various not only aspects and actions, but various emotions as well. And this painting include kriya or action, bhav or mood, ras or sentiment. Now, it was through these various actions that the painter of Ajanta has communicated his idea of harsh, that is joy, sorrow, that is visad, greed, that is lobh, compassion is karuna, and various other moods of individual. And the painter has been quite successful in expressing these various moods of the subjects that he has drawn on the walls of Ajanta. Now, Ajanta painter was mainly concerned with paintings of Buddhism or themes related to Buddhism. There is a problem in these paintings, and the problem is that these paintings are not chronological in order. For example, if the painter is depicting a particular story on the walls, the unfolding of pictures is not sequential or chronological in order. Now, this probably might be because of Buddhist philosophy, where the concept or the idea of time was in fact subjective. So, this can be the reason for this problem, but nevertheless, it is very difficult to decipher the story on the basis of paintings unless one is familiar with the story concerned. Now, as far as the technique of this painting is concerned, the way the wall has been prepared, the way the surface has been prepared, and the way the canvas has been prepared, the background for these paintings has been prepared. Scholars call it fresco painting, but actually this is not true fresco painting. It is actually fresco secco painting, the technique adopted in Ajanta paintings that is suggested by the experts. Now, as far as colors used in these paintings are concerned, most of these colors were drawn from natural sources. For example, red and yellow color was drawn from red and yellow ochre. White color was drawn from kaolin or china clay. Black color was drawn from lamp black, and blue was obtained from lapis lazuli. Now, in this process, we have the paintings of Ajanta being made in various caves, different caves of Ajanta. And if we talk about some popular paintings of Ajanta, one can mention about Hasti Jatak, Visantara, Mahajanak, and Vidura Pandit. So, besides it, we have also some painting remains from the caves of Badami and Ellora and various other places, Aurangabad as well. But as because of limited time, we cannot discuss all those paintings here. So, from Ajanta paintings, we move on to another art that was very significant, and it also flourished to a great extent during Gupta period, and that is the art of sculpture. Now, Gupta sculpture can be seen in continuation with post-Mauryan sculpture, with a difference that whereas in post-Mauryan period the emphasis was more on flora and fauna, and human was just represented as part of this flora and fauna, whereas in Gupta sculpture we find that the emphasis or thrust of the sculptor is more on human form rather than flora and fauna. And actually, Gupta sculpture used the human figure as the vehicle for transmutation of nature into art. So, Gupta sculptor preferred all the forms of a sculpture mostly in human form. Now, the symptoms of Gupta sculpture art emerged from two schools, from Mathura and Amaravati. Because Mathura and Amaravati were already there in post-Mauryan times, and they were very important centers or very important schools of sculptural art during post-Mauryan times. So, Gupta sculptural art can be seen in continuation of Mathura and Amaravati sculpture, with a difference that whereas in Mathura and Gupta period, there was not that kind of maturity that we have during Mathura and Amaravati schools. We have not that maturity that we witness in Gupta school, because Mathura school was famous for its high degree of excellence in plasticity. Amaravati school was known for its elegance. But if we look at Gupta school of sculpture, it was a combination of both excellence in plasticity as well as excellence. So it has been rightly suggested by some scholars that the maturity of Gupta period can be said to have its adolescence in Mathura and Amaravati school. Now, if we look at various features of Gupta sculpture, what we find that these sculptures are more presentable, sensible and plastic as compared to previous times, because the sensitivity and plasticity of Gupta sculpture is tremendous. Another important feature of Gupta sculpture is that the torso, the upper portion of the body, seems to be full with inner width. So it gives some expression of strength from the from inside the body. Now, as far as eyebrows in Gupta sculpture are concerned, they are very softly rounded. The lips are of course fleshy and eyes are semi-open. Eyelids are fleshy, eyes are semi-open, and the eyelids beneath the eyelids are well-defined. So they seem to appear quite natural or realistic in nature as compared to the human form created during pre-Gupta times. Here also you will find that the transparency of drapery is very important and very fine, and the overall expression of this sculpture is quite contemplative. What we call Manansil Mudra in Hindi, it's quite contemplative in that sense of time. So as we said that the lead for this Gupta sculpture is obtained from Mathura school, and from Mathura it moved on to Sarnath, and Mathura actually, this features of Mathura were adopted by Sarnath, and it was Sarnath who took this art of a sculpture during Gupta period to a climax. Now, if we look at the earliest examples during Gupta period, what we find that the earliest example is that of a statue of the Buddha. It is basically the statue of a Bodhisattva that comes from Bodh Gaya, which was made sometimes in 4th century AD. Though this is one of the earliest statues that was made during Gupta period, and that is why it also bears certain characteristic features of Mathura school belonging to the period of Kusanas, wherein you have the massiveness of the statue, where there is stoidity, bhavsunyata as we call it. But the statue is in standing posture, and in the figure is in Abhay Mudra. So a very popular figure that was adopted in the making of the statues of the Buddha. And at the back of this statue, rather on behind the head of this statue, there is a halo or Abha Mandal which emerged during this period. Now, apart from it, if we look at fundamental features, we have already seen that there were various features that were started by Mathura and refined by Sarnath. So Sarnath is said to have, because after Mathura, during Gupta period, Sarnath becomes a more important and popular center of sculpture, and various masterpieces of Gupta's period sculptures were prepared at Sarnath. And if we talk about some of the sculptures that prepared at Sarnath, because Sarnath phase is known as the classical phase of sculpture in India, the very, very famous statue that comes from Sarnath is again of a Buddha who is portrayed as depicting his first sermon. Now, in this particular statue, the Buddha is seated in Vajra Paryanka Mudra with with hands deposed in teaching gesture, and that is called Dharma Chakra Mudra, and he is also shown as seated on a throne. So he is seated like a teacher and he is sitting in a teaching posture called Vajra Paryanka Mudra. Now, behind this statue, behind the head of this statue is a decorated halo, and on the other side of this nimbus is a flying figure of Gandharva. This is a very significant addition that we do not find in previous statues. Now, other important images of the of this school included the head of Buddha, which is there in the National Museum, Delhi, and there are another three standing images of the Buddha, which are there in the museum in Kolkata. Now, as we said, the ideas started from Mathura, refined and taken to climax by Sarnath, but it did not remain confined to Mathura and Sarnath only. This idea of sculpture gradually developed, rather spread all over India, and this idea in fact produced several masterpieces in different parts in Eastern India, Western India, and even Central India. Now, besides sculptures in stone and some metal sculptures, the popular expression of art or sculpture is found in terracottas. Terracottas, as we know, is a medium that is easily available and it can be used by anybody. So the popular expression or masses expression of sculptural ideas by the masses can be found in various terracottas spread throughout the country during the Gupta period, and that again was related to common people. So here again, just as in the case of literature, we saw that most of the literature was court literature or literature that catered to elite people only. In sculptural category also, we have that large number of sculptural remains is basically court, maybe it's most likely that it was patronized by the court, whereas the masses satisfied themselves with terracotta sculptures. Now, apart from sculpture, another category of art in Gupta period can be seen in the spheres of architecture. Now, architecture is a field in which Gupta period can be said to be the turning point in history of Indian architecture, because previous architectures were mostly cave excavations, though these caves were related to various religions, like various contemporary religions like Brahmanism, Buddhism, and Jainism. But even this cave architecture was refined and rebuilt and taken to its pinnacle during Gupta period only. Now, it's also important to know here that this cave architecture, which reached its climax during Gupta period, also witnessed its decline in Gupta period itself, because some of the important specimen of cave architecture in fact come from Gupta period. They are spread all over the country again, and they come from Gupta period. So the techniques adopted by the previous artists of cave architecture was further refined during Gupta period, and it was taken to excellence. But it is also a fact, and rather unfortunate fact, that this art also comes to an end during Gupta period only. So very significant tradition, a great tradition in architecture that was started in ancient India, witnesses its decline during Gupta period. But this was happening on the one hand. On the other hand, what we find that there was tremendous growth and development of structural form and style. Construction and construction with the help of bricks, with the help of stone. So this form of architecture starts gaining momentum during Gupta period, and in this form of architecture again we have erection of a number of architectures related to various religion, especially Buddhism and Brahmanism, which are in the form of stupas, chaityas and a few temples as well. Now here in this particular lecture we shall limit ourselves to temple architecture only, because Gupta period is noteworthy for erection of temples. Now these temples were erected for enshrinement of images of various deities, and in fact the earliest or the extant temple remains that we have today come from Gupta period, though this practice may have been there earlier too, but the remains are not available. So the earliest temples available in our country belong to Gupta period, and in this category too very few examples have survived, and there too remains are very fragmentary. But nevertheless, on the basis of these remains of structural architecture, we can suggest, rather it is suggested by scholars, that there were four well-defined groups of temples which were recognized during Gupta period, and which constitute an age of experiment as well, because it was the beginning of temple architecture in India, and the kind of temples that we have in early medieval or medieval times were definitely not made, because the mastery over the construction of these temples was not acquired during Gupta period. So it was an age of experiment from the point of view of structural construction, and that is why the temples that we have are also not very refined. But nevertheless, we can identify four categories that emerged during Gupta period, and these four categories have a few specimens available even today that we shall discuss one by one in our lecture. Now the first category that we have in temple architecture is the earliest category probably, which is a flat roof temple, flat roof square temple, and on the front of it there was a shallow porch. Now there are certain examples, though these were not very popular in North India, but there are a few examples in which it was a rectangular room as well, but mostly what we have is that square rooms which were created, because these rooms were the garbhagrihas where the deity was kept. So first category is of one solitary square, generally speaking, one solitary square shaped room, the roof is flat and there is small porch in front of the gate. There is no shikhar, there is no viman or the slanting structure that we witnessed during earlier time. During first phase, it was a flat roof temple, small square shaped room. That was the garbhagriha. Now, if we talk about examples of this category, one can talk about the Kankali Devi temple at Tigwa in Jabalpur district, the temple of Vishnu and Varaha in Iran in Sagar district, and the temple at Nachna Kuthar. Now all these three temples are there in Madhya Pradesh, and these are very significant example of this group of temple, which was a square shaped flat roofed small porse temple structure. Now the second category of temple was a flat roofed square temple with a covered ambulatory surrounding the garbhagriha. Now this was preceded by a porch in the front, sometimes with a second story above the garbhagriha. So this was another important category. What you find that whereas in the first category it was a small square room, in second category this small square room was surrounded by ambulatory space that is called Pradakshina Path. People take the round of this garbhagriha after performing the puja. Now sometimes what you find in this category that this there is another story added to it, but it's not general. What is important in this category, which differentiates it from the first category, is addition of ambulatory space or Pradakshina Path, and again the porse in front was slightly bigger than the previous porse. Now if we talk about examples of this category, Parvati temple at Nachna Kuthar and Shiva temple at Bhumara, again these two temples are from Madhya Pradesh. These two temples can be said to be the example of second category, where the flat roofed garbhagriha is surrounded by Pradakshina Path with a bigger porse and sometimes with a second story. But the roof was still flat, there was no shikhar or viman or the slanting structure that we witnessed in a common temple. Now the third category of these temples was a temple with a low squat tower or shikhar over it. So what we find during third stage of temple construction in Gupta period is that the garbhagriha is again a square shaped, but there is low squat tower or shikhar, because the technique was not as developed to make a bigger shikhar that we witnessed during later times. But the beginning or the construction of shikhar had started during Gupta period itself in the third stage of temple construction. Though it was smaller, it was lower, and though we have no extant temple in this category or in this style that can be exactly placed in 6th century, but the contemporary literature suggests that such temples were in fact being constructed. Now the fourth category of temple is that of circular temple, which had shallow projections at the four cardinal directions, east, west, north and south, and it was a very rare category because very few temples in this style have been constructed in India, especially in North India during Gupta period. And a solitary example of this temple in fact comes from Rajgir, and this temple is known as Maniyar Math or the Shrine of Maninag, which is in Rajgir in Bihar. So this way we can see that the various stages of development of temple structure had been obtained during Gupta period itself. Though the structures were not magnificent as they happened to be during early medieval times or medieval times, but all the styles, all the methods of construction of temple have been devised during Gupta period, which were further refined and developed in later times to come. So this way we can see that Gupta period, from the point of view of literature, art, especially painting and sculpture and architecture, was a period which defines or laid the foundation of different aspects of art and culture, and it stands as a landmark in the history of India from the point of view of art, culture and architecture. Thank you so much.
Truly golden period we can say, because we find a number of things that were introduced those times, and later days we find the manifestation. So friend, we come to know the literature, art and architecture. So I hope you have got the point, and with this word we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. On your behalf, I thank Dr. O.P. Singh for giving such a wonderful lecture on this great topic. Thank you very much.